Meditation and Hypnotherapy, the truth about hypnotherapy and our natural trance abilities to meditate, doing personal problem solving. We are far better equipped spiritually and mentally than previously known or understood. We are to be renewed in the spirit of our mind. This information belongs to W. Dennis Parker Enterprises, Inc., doing business as Certified Hypnotherapy Training and School. Copyright 2012, all rights reserved. Part 3, Hypnotherapy or Meditation, Personal Problem Solving, Becoming Clear and Free-Minded. Hypnotherapy or meditation is the intentional induction of trance or pondering for personal problem-solving therapeutic purposes. Learn personal problem-solving skills and resolve past sensitizing events and experiences that are still holding us back, inhibiting us from being who we want to be, really are supposed to be, meant to be. References to meditation. In his law doth he meditate day and night. Psalms. Consider my meditation. Psalms. And the meditation of my heart shall be of understanding. Psalms. Meditate upon these things. 1 Timothy. I lay musing, pondering on the singularity of the scene, marveling greatly at what had been told to me by this extraordinary messenger, when in the midst of my meditation I suddenly discovered that my room was again beginning to get lighted. Pearl of great price.
Another one, Proverbs 4, 26 and 27 says, ponder the path of thy feet, and let all thy ways be established. Turn not to the right hand, nor to the left. Remove thy foot from evil. So we are to ponder the path of our feet and understand that. And again, that is what we're proposing that we're doing here. And, you know, in the worldly view, again, we're calling it hypnosis and hypnotherapy because it is. But also in the spiritual view, if you come in and you come in more prepared, if you will, and people accomplish great things, overcome all kinds of problems, because this process is really about personal problem solving. And we teach people how to do personal problem solving through the use of their own mind and understanding their own thought processes.
My name is Wendy, and I am 38, married with two children. I worked with Dennis 20 years ago when I was a senior in high school. Was having some problems with my emotions and understanding why I was sad a lot. So he took me through a lot of mind management. And as I learned about conscious imagination, memory, emotion, he taught me how to move through each section of my mind. And as I did so, I was able to understand why I was feeling the way I was. As I've gone through the years, I've noticed that when I have a situation that I don't understand or I'm reacting in a way that is contrary to what I feel I should, I go into my memory and find out why, and I've been able to pull past situations that explain why I would react the way I would, and then I would be able to handle it, let it go, and move forward. I have found the more that I live in my imagination, I can create emotions within myself that are positive or negative, and I also find out that the more I live in the emotion aspect of myself, that I find that it helps me when I need to grieve or be happy, but then I can also pull out of it when I need to be logical. So I think that after 20 years, I've been able to move within my mind in ways that has been very positive. I find that if I need to understand things, it is easier for me to find the knowledge that I have to move forward. And I feel that if I did not have that in my life, I think I would be a lot I would be lost, and I wouldn't be able to understand and help my children and help others. I think as we understand ourselves, we are able to reach out and help others a lot more effectively.
We are to overcome our double-mindedness. A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. James. Double-mindedness is a state of holding opposing beliefs in the conscious and subconscious levels of our mind that cause opposing forces within ourselves. We start, we stop, we try to move forward, we hesitate. Eliminating double-mindedness will bring stability into our lives. We will make consistent, righteous choices, and our actions will be positive and acceptable. We will be overcoming, and you can fill in the blank here with any behavioral modification or problem that you want to address. Eliminating double-mindedness will bring added clarity between good and evil, right and wrong, worthy and unworthy, and we will become more stable in all of our ways.
Say that one again.
I've missed the fun part of me.
Yeah. Do you love her? Are you old enough, wise enough, smart enough, mature enough to protect her, take care of her, and go out and help her have a beautiful, wonderful life?
Mm-hmm.
Is there any reason at all why you can't do that? No more excuses.
No lies popped up.
How cool is that?
That's cool.
Anything else you want to say to her right there, or she needs to say to you? Did you get what you came for today?
Yeah.
Yeah? Anything else you want to talk about today or spend time on today?
Just decided I didn't believe I was capable of feeling happy. Like, truly.
You're not just faking it there, are you?
No.
You're truly, really happy.
You're right, I can't stop smiling.
You can't stop smiling? That's a problem to have. You just can't stop smiling.
That's cool. I've never felt that I can remember.
I know, you just got a big grin from ear to ear. You just keep it up. You're going to wear out those smile muscles here in a minute. You have to. Good job. I just want you to know I am very, very pleased and proud of you for the work you've done today. I know it's been tough. I know this isn't even easy. But I admire you for getting in and sticking with it and getting it done. You're one tough lady. You deserve to be happy. Be happy. Do the same for your daughter. Help her be happy. She deserves it too.
Mm-hmm.
Thriving survivors. Doing life new and different. And enjoying every minute of it. Stronger, healthier, whole, well. Just enjoy those feelings, and then whenever you're ready, you can just open your eyes and come back here and be with me.
It's always really bright.
What's that?
It's really bright.
Really bright?
Yeah. Thank you.
Oh, thank you. Good job.
Let's just chat about that for a minute, Kim. You know, when you say it's really bright, part of that is just because you've had your eyes closed for a while and the room's dark. But a lot of people also talk about it when they come out of that state and they clear up all of that kind of stuff. They kind of describe like they can actually look around the room and the room's brighter and that they actually see things clearer because they're not. Are you noticing that?
Yeah, I have experienced that before.
When we finish the sessions?
Yeah.
Well, look around the room right now. Look over there at the plaques and over here at the picture and the pictures on the wall. And look totally outward here for just a minute. And how would you describe that differently?
More vibrant.
More vibrant? Meaning?
Just like the colors. And
it's clear?
Yeah.
Yeah.
The other scriptural-based concept for hypnosis and hypnotherapy that we want to explain is, and one of my favorite scriptures on this is James 1 and 8. A double-minded man is unstable in all of his ways. Well, that double-mindedness means that the conscious mind believes and knows and wants to do one thing. It knows that, you know, we ought to do this or that, you know, read our scriptures every day, say our prayers, you know, all of those kinds of things it knows that we ought to be doing. And yet at a subconscious level, we are doing and believing something else again. So we have this incongruency in our thought that at some points we have a goal, we move forward, we stop. We move forward, we hesitate. We know we ought to spend this time doing this, and we procrastinate. And so we get this double-mindedness, this instability, if you will, in our actions.
And what that means is for the rest of your life, I want you to have a conscious awareness where you're at in your own mind. And what happens to people, and the difference in therapy of what we do is that people will get a predominant thought that they over-amplify in their imagination, and they get stuck or fixated in the memory, or they get stuck and fixated on the emotion, or they get stuck and fixated in the imagination, whichever is the strongest. And in what we've done, what we work with you on, is we do systematic desensitization. We desensitize the imagination, we alter the perception of the memory, therefore we collapse the emotion. Now you're free to come back to full consciousness and have full management of your own mind.
I like it.
You like it? Mm-hmm. You understand it now too, don't you?
Mm-hmm.
Make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Any questions for me before we wrap this up?
I don't think so.
Good for you. High five, kid. Good job.
Thank you.
I'm proud of you.
Thank you.
You've done some great work here.
Well, thanks for teaching me.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks for all your efforts.
I'm excited.
Yeah, this isn't easy work to do, you know, and it takes somebody like you that's willing to come in and get after it and not be afraid to take on the challenge of whatever's in their mind. It's so ironic that people are afraid of what's in their own head.
Mm-hmm.
And yet they deal with it every day anyway by suppressing it and trying to hang on to it. And, you know, it's so much easier in life, really, just to deal with it, let go, but move on. You agree with that?
Agreed.
Just like you said, you're not ready to go to school and you're excited about it.
Mm-hmm.
You're not crying anymore.
No way. Such a wimp.
Such a wimp. Are you a wimp?
Sometimes.
Huh?
Sometimes. Not anymore.
Not anymore.
Oh.
That's what I was looking for. Good job. That's it.
Cool.
And you mentioned that, you know, we visited with a number of your children.
Mm-hmm.
I think all of them at some point.
Mm-hmm.
And how's that gone for you?
Good. Seeing improvements in each one. Some maybe not as much because some are a little more, but the rest really good.
I haven't done as many sessions with each of them as I have with others.
Right.
So the ones that I have worked with over a period of time, well, like your oldest daughter.
Mackenzie.
Yeah, she's doing...
She's doing awesome. She's gone to school.
She's gone to school?
Mm-hmm.
How's she doing?
Awesome. She's got some great roommates, and she's excited now. She's a wreck before.
And she was a real delight. She had told me when she first came in here, and we got talking, and she was talking about school. She says, I cry myself to sleep every day thinking I have to go away to school.
Do it again, I know.
Yeah.
She's had, I told her third time's the charm. And she's had two things haven't worked out real well. Third time. Gonna be great.
There you go.
She's excited.
Well, if you were going to say anything to anybody about what you've seen and experienced here, what would you say about the sessions and what you've been able to learn out of them so far?
Well, I always knew the brain had a capacity to do great things, but I had no idea the power of the brain and how to use it. I haven't had skills or anything to go by on that, so you know that it's powerful, but you don't have any clue how to control it, and learned a lot from that, and I've seen huge responses from that, and life-changing things for some of my kids, so yeah, I'm thrilled. It's been good.
This work is to assist our families, ourselves, and others to overcome double-mindedness. We can have the personal power of mind to find freedom from those predominant thought, self-limiting beliefs that bind us down, hold us back, and keep us from moving forward in life in positive ways. We are to become more stable in our righteous ways and consistently overcome the temptations of life, choosing to do the good we instinctively know is in us from our God-given conscience, and over the evil we may think, as a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. Draw nigh unto God, and he will draw nigh unto you. Cleanse your hands, ye sinners, and purify your hearts, ye double-minded. Benefits of trance utilization. Access to all subconscious functions and every sensory perception. Every touch, every smell, every sound, every conversation, everything felt, heard, or viewed from birth until now is all stored in the subconscious and is available through trance, pondering, or hypnosis access. We can deal with what is and not just with what some people may think it is. Again, most all of us have had several experiences in life that are sensitizing us, meaning we are still emotional when these experiences come to mind. We are still hurt, angry, resentful, anxious, sad, and so forth, even though the experience was many years ago. We can be free of past experiences and inhibitions, and not only be survivors, but become thriving survivors. The truth sets us free. The accepted lies, misunderstandings, misperceptions, misrepresentations of ourself to ourself, our misinterpretations, are to be cleared up by pondering upon the experience and coming to know our real personal truths. You can know your personal truths about your past experiences. Which of your past experiences are still holding you back, binding you down, keeping you from being what you want to be, keeping you from being who you are meant to be, in your heart, the person you know you are supposed to be? Most will guess but really don't know, because they have buried those hurts years ago in our subconscious mind with amnesia and denial.
So let's just chat for just a minute.
Mm-hmm.
What changes have you noticed since the last time we worked together?
I'm always a lot more happier.
Yeah?
I'm lots of times smiling. I don't even know why. I'm just smiling and I'm just happy.
Good for you.
And lots of times I don't even know why, I just know that I'm happy. And that's why I tell people, they're like, why are you always so happy now? I was like, I'm just happy. I just feel like smiling. I just feel like happy. That's why I tell people, because I really don't know myself either. I'm happy.
Yeah. So it's some people say when they first start this, they say, you know what was nice about that is that when we finish the sessions, I used to have to pretend that I was happy at church or I was happy at a party or something, but they make a comment just like you just said, now I just am happy. Is that kind of the way it...
Yeah, like you can't really describe or even know yourself why you're happy, and you can't explain that to other people, you're happy.
And you've noticed that since the last time we worked together?
I've noticed it more, though, because people tell me that I'm just always happy now.
But that first day she said we left from here, and when we got home she went with her grandma and grandpa somewhere, and she was just all smiley, and they were like, you're really happy, and she thought, yeah, I don't remember being happy since I was five. This is the first time I've been happy since I was five.
I have five kids. How cool is that?
So, but that's been 11 years.
Yeah.
So... To go from being that happy, or not being that happy for 11 years, to being happy, it would make a difference. So.
Yeah. I like your bright eyes, too.
Thanks.
Very pretty. Good job. Well, we wanted to do a follow-up with you. I know you had a big session last time. You did a lot of work. And I know that was kind of traumatic for you. But you stayed with it, you got through it, and...
I wouldn't go back and change it either. I'm glad that I did it, so...
You're glad that you did it? You know, that's one of the things that people worry about sometimes when we talk to them about doing hypnosis. And, well, yeah, they might know what my secrets are, or what I've been through, or... You know what I mean?
Actually, if there's any secrets, I end up saying... I don't know what's going on here. As long as Nancy doesn't tell my mom.
Are you saying you need me to go out for a...
No. Because it's a good thing that you know my secrets. I just don't want you to.
Well, I congratulate you for being willing to come in and actually, you know, what we call do your work, you know, which is figure out those things that are still bothering you from the past or caused you to be sensitized in some ways that are, you know, maybe holding you back from, well, being as happy as you are. So today I just want to do a little check with you and see where you're at and frankly see if anything else comes up that maybe still be bothering you or not. And if not, then we're going to teach you some other cool things. And if there are, we'll clear those up, and then we'll teach you some cool things. How would that be?
Okay.
She is worried that she's like, I don't even know what's working on. I said, it's okay. They'll handle it. The thing is your mind knows whether or not there's something you need to work on.
No, I don't think my mind knows either.
Your subconscious mind knows.
Well, you're the only one that does, so we'll find that out in just a second. So you ready to do that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. You know from last time, all we need you to do is just get very relaxed. It's going to be like going half asleep again.
Mm-hmm.
So if you would, if you just close your eyes down.
What do you invest in? A job? Education? How about a family trip and recreation? Your retirement? Children and spouse. If you had the opportunity to invest in yourself for the future in ways that will greatly improve you and your life, would you? Especially if the opportunity is guaranteed. And what if we gave you a way to do it at less than half the price? Are there old experiences from your past that are still bothering you? The ones that when you think or talk about them, you are still emotionally sensitized. These sensitizations are the uncomfortable feelings that tend to hold us back and bind us down from moving forward in life. Imagine your mind and life being clear and free of past sensitizations and useless mind chatter. Imagine being free to accomplish your goals without hesitations and procrastinations, consistently and constantly moving forward. What would it be worth to you and your family to overcome self-limiting beliefs and personal doubts? Eliminate old unwanted habits and conquer maladaptive behaviors, such as overeating, trouble sleeping, pornography, electronic games, and other time and life-wasting behaviors. We will teach you how to do so utilizing mind management. If you want to have greater self-confidence, enhance self-esteem, personal impulse control, and have a system that really works to improve your life, please watch the following presentation. What we are offering will be of dramatic impact on your life. You will enjoy learning and utilizing mind management. Advanced Health Clinic is where Dennis works as a contract hypnotherapist for the clinic. Dennis does individual sessions of hypnotherapy as well as group trainings in mind management.
A school teaching hypnotherapy will open January 6th in Farmington. Certified hypnotherapist and director of the school, Dennis Parker, says the school will be a place for people to learn how to help others as well as themselves.
The idea there is that everybody can come in and dump off all of their own behavioral issues and get their own life in order, so to speak, so they're in a position to understand what clients go through, because now they've been through it.
Parker says hypnotherapy can help teachers understand their students, doctors treat their patients, parents help their children, as well as cure individuals of destructive habits.
And a new school in Farmington is teaching self-help through hypnosis. The Certified Training School's Advanced Health Clinic was started by W. Dennis Parker, who says the idea behind hypnosis is that there are six trance states
that we can observe and that we can help people stop their mind, if you will, in that level. And we know what therapeutic benefit each level of trance as someone goes off to sleep has for therapeutic purposes.
And Parker says by stopping the mind in one of those trance states, a person can learn better self-control, anger management, sports performance enhancement, weight loss, and self-confidence. KSL News Time.
This is also where Certified Hypnotherapy Training School is held and broadcast nationwide. Advanced Health Clinic brings together talented doctors and therapists from different modalities to provide traditional and alternative natural healing methods and practices into a blend of services which are calculated to meet individual needs, providing appropriate benefits to each client. Please look for our new ebook that has all the details. There are three parts to this presentation. We hope you see, hear, and feel what we are attempting to communicate: the introduction, the course and process, and the conclusion. How fast can someone walk? How fast can a car go? How fast can an airplane go? How fast can a fighter jet go? How fast can a space shuttle go? How fast is the speed of light? Is there something faster than the speed of light? Behavior modification can be faster than the speed of light when accomplished at the speed of thought. Going past light speed means that we're accomplishing our changes at the speed of thought. The speed of thought then becomes the speed of our change, which takes us at change past the speed of light. A mind management experience is twofold: one, the speed at which we can make behavioral change, and two, the speed at which we can move forward to reach new levels of performance and achievement once the change happens. What is a paradigm shift? Do you allow for new points of view to be viewed by you? Why do some people believe it takes 21 days to develop a new behavior? What if the time frame of change was more about the method of implementation rather than the truth about how fast change can occur? How do you achieve change at the speed of thought? Let's first consider the following. What was the thought of the world during 1492? But what do we know now? What was the thought about flying at the turn of the 19th century? But what do we know now? What was the thought on the afternoon of April 14, 1912? What do we know now? Certainly, history would never repeat, but it does. January 13, 2012. Does history repeat itself within our own lives, our families, and our loved ones? Do we continue to make the same or similar mistakes of the past? If so, why do we do that? How come we allow it? Have we reached a level that we just can't seem to move beyond? Have we actually reached our peak, or are we stuck in the same old rut and just don't know how to free ourselves? What is holding me back? What are the roots of my behavioral problems? How do I accomplish positive change? Consider this. Rapid change in beliefs and behavior modifications are far easier to achieve than previously ever imagined. We will give you some insight into how this change process happens. How do you achieve change at the speed of thought? How it works is really quite simple once you understand the principles behind it. Have you ever thought about this, conscious versus subconscious? Cognitively, we know what our conscious thoughts are, but it takes trance access to know what is in the subconscious mind. The iceberg. The reality that a person has a conscious and subconscious is not new. However, the concept that it takes trance access to change it has never been explained in this way, has it? Why hasn't it? Once a person understands how this works, solving any problem is much easier because they know how to attack it. The solution has to take place in the subconscious mind in order to truly be effective. That's at its core. What is the problem with moving forward? How does it really work? 10 to 15% of our mind is conscious. 85 to 90% is subconscious. The problem then is double-mindedness, because incongruent, unaligned core beliefs between the conscious and the subconscious minds cause us to vacillate, move forward, fall back, making us unstable in our ways. When we align the subconscious core beliefs with our conscious decisions and goals, we make changes faster than the speed of light at the speed of thought. The mind. Remember, 10% of the mind is consciousness, while 90% is made up of our subconscious. It simply stands to reason that our subconscious mind becomes the motivating force behind who and what we are and how we behave. It's like a giant locomotive. Once we realize the power of this concept, things become clear. A train engineer, the conscious mind, controls a massive locomotive once he is properly trained. Without proper training and understanding, the engine, the subconscious mind, can run unrestrained. Are there areas of your life out of control and running unrestrained? Do you know of anyone running unrestrained? Is it because we've allowed our subconscious mind to operate out of control? What effect would an incorrect belief have on yourself, your family, or others? How would it affect behaviors and relationships? Correcting the belief. This is an illustration of how an incorrect belief, once established and allowed to remain, has the potential to exaggerate and compromise the stability of any person, organization, or structure. The Titanic and the Costa Concordia are prime examples of this concept. Both were believed to be unsinkable. Correcting the belief allows the foundation to come back into plumb, and the structure stabilizes and remains strong. Things can and really do fall back into their proper place. What if you knew that your subconscious mind may be limiting your ability to perform at your best and keeping you from desired new levels of achievement? The mind has the ability to have conscious and subconscious functions at the same time at a certain trance level. You understand that this is one powerful concept. Opening such a conduit is really not hard. However, it has not been understood because of the current thoughts of our day about hypnosis. Sound familiar? Let's call it pondering or trance. Relaxation. Trance or hypnosis for hypnotherapy is like going half asleep. Relaxation is the key that opens the door, allowing the mind to have conscious and subconscious functions at the same time. It gives the individual access to the power contained in the subconscious engine, allowing the conscious mind to control the subconscious, reining in the oft-times runaway train. Relaxation is as easy as closing your eyes and thinking in your mind of one of your favorite places, whether it be the beach, the mountains, or any other pleasant place. Taking a minute to go to that favorite place in your mind is relaxing. Subconscious imaginations, memories, and emotions can work for or against us as determined by the correctness of our core beliefs. Subconscious functions, memories, imaginations, and emotions. Memory. Everything you have ever done, said, seen, thought, or felt is all contained in your memories and can be accessed through trance, pondering, or hypnosis, as long as there is no physical incapacity. Imaginations. Can magnify and amplify our thoughts and emotions from 0 to 2,500 times their original impressions. Emotions are generated from accepted predominant thought beliefs that become over-amplified in our imaginations. The more imaginary amplification, the stronger the emotional content becomes over time. How behaviors are created, challenged, and changed through trance hypnotherapy. We want you to know that we follow an actual system, if you will, a methodology of how we track, challenge, and change inappropriate behaviors and beliefs. We teach this chart to everyone who enters our mind management courses or who obviously becomes a student in the school. You will learn how to become your own best behavioral therapist as you learn to fully understand, practice, and utilize what's on this chart. Stay tuned as we continue to piece things together, because principles 6 through 10 are so critical to the understanding of personal mind management. We spend nearly 3 hours during the course to explain them. It is like taking pieces of a treasure map and laying them out carefully on a table. Once they are all in place, the location of the treasure is clearly visible, and we know for certain the path to take in order to find it. The following explanation will bring the concept more clearly into focus. rain. The concept in simple form. Johnny and Mary, they are neighbors experiencing the same rain, lightning, and thunderstorm. Johnny's belief system, I hate rain. I really hate rain. Mary's belief system, I love rain. I love everything about rain. In the morning, Johnny wakes up to the sound of rain. Instantly, he has the following thought pattern because he's focused only on those things about rain that he can hate. He has skewed his view of the world and everything around him about rain to only acknowledge, accept, recognize, understand the things about rain that are unpleasant or that he can hate. My lawn will be wet. I can't get into my garden to pull the weeds. I just washed my car. Now it's a mess and it will be a mess all day. I'll have to clean it again. I don't like the heavy moisture in the air. My wool suit will smell because it's going to be wet. I hate those worms on the sidewalk. Looks like the day is just ruined. What does Johnny believe about rain? I hate rain. How does he behave on rainy days? The same morning, Mary wakes up to the sound of rain. Instantly, she has the following thought pattern. She doesn't want to be wrong either, so she's only looking for those things about rain that she can like, love, and enjoy. Wow, I just fertilized my lawn. It's going to get so green. My garden can use the extra water. I don't have to wash my car. The air smells so fresh every time it rains. I can finally use the umbrella I just bought. It's okay to step over the worms on the sidewalk. Today things are going to turn out great. What does Mary believe about rain? I love rain. How does she behave on rainy days? Just the same as she does on sunny days. It makes no difference to her. Every day, rainy or sunny, is a great day for Mary. Let's review what we just saw. We have the same rainstorm, same stimulus. We have two opposite belief systems and patterns. Two completely different reactions and behaviors. One day, two separate outcomes, one positive, one negative. Mary loves rain and always has. Correct belief? Yes, it works great for her in the short and long term. Johnny hates rain and has for a long time. Incorrect belief? Yes, destined for failure in the short and long term. Why? Because core beliefs inside the subconscious can either help or hurt. Correct the subconscious core beliefs, which in turn will generate thoughts and life changes at, beyond or past the speed of light, at the speed of thought. How do we get changes in the subconscious? Let's go back to Johnny and I hate rain, an incorrect belief. If we could go back in time and find out how and why the I hate rain belief first came into being and correct that belief, would that change Johnny's life in a dramatic way? Furthermore, what about the lives of everyone around him on rainy days? Let's go back 30 years ago. Relaxation, again, is the key. Gives the mind the ability to have conscious and subconscious functions at the same time. Again, one powerful concept. At this point, most react in their minds by discounting the possibility that such a concept can truly happen. One spring, 30 years ago, Johnny was 6 years old. He was stuck inside and couldn't go out to play for 3 straight days. He kept staring out the window at his toys in the front yard and at his friend's house next door. He was upset and angry that he was all cooped up in the house and made the decision that, I hate rain. I really hate rain. 30 years later, he remains stuck in this belief and acts like he is still 6 years old on rainy days. We want to now take you through the inductive behavioral producing processes and deductive discovery, challenging, and behavioral change processes.
This chart is going to teach you in a simplified way how behaviors are created and made and how we change them with hypnosis and hypnotherapy. Okay? So what we want to recognize is that your fears, your positive self-talk, your anxieties, all the stress in your back, the things that you're doing, your confidence, are all coming from a common denominator, if you will, which what we would say is that it's coming from a stimulus. So to start our behavior, let's start right on the top line. The IP stands for inductive processing. Now, inductive processing says that a behavior is induced through a process. So it doesn't just happen. We actually have a process that actually induces the behaviors that we have. And what we would tell you is that the inductive processing starts with a stimulus. Now, that stimulus means that it's coming from an experience that you've had. And sometimes those experiences, when we first come into hypnotherapy, end up being childhood issues. If you've never really worked through your childhood issues, those things come up first. And I did a lady who'd really never been into therapy before, and she was going to go on a cruise and was all concerned about going on a cruise at 78, never had these fears and concerns. So she came in, you know, and we started right back at 3 and 4 year old issues, grade school issues, all of those things that get stuck in our mind. Whenever they get stuck there, they stay there until we challenge and change them, no matter at what age. And we carry those stimuluses with us in the form of buried thoughts until we actually can go back in and address them. So these stimuluses generate thoughts. Now, the 4 stimuluses that we experience in life is the environment, meaning that we get up in the morning and we see that it's raining outside. And so we adjust for rain. You know, we change our leather shoes to our neoprene sole shoes and, you know, that kind of stuff. We make certain behavioral adjustments for rain. The next stimulus is our peers. Now, we allow peers to stand for really any other human being and also language like radio, TV, media, other kinds of cartoons for little kids, language, people, that kind of stuff. The next one is the central nervous system. Now, in the central nervous system, it generates thoughts, and the story that I use is I remember as a little kid, I was helping my dad build a barn, and I thought I was like big stuff because these guys were sawing and cutting off these boards, and my job was to stack the boards in the wood pile, and a lot of these boards, we were building a barn out of used wood, and they had a lot of old nails in them. So my job was to take the boards over into the wood pile and pull all the old used nails out, and that kind of thing. And I remember one time I was in my gym shoes, and I walked over and I felt this pressure on the bottom of my foot, but I never felt that before, and so I just stepped forward and kept walking. When I did, I pushed a nail right up through the bottom of my foot, came right up through the top of my gym shoe, and I literally had nailed that board to the bottom of my foot. And of course, as a little kid, I started crying. I think I was like 5 or 6 years old, you know. Dad, look at this. And I held up my foot, and there's this board dangling off the bottom of my foot, you know. And if you know my dad, I mean, he's always had John Wayne as his hero, you know. He's always thought he was John Wayne. In his house, he has a John Wayne room. You know, it's kind of like the shrine to John Wayne, you know,
pictures of John Wayne on that pinto horse going up the that trail, you know, that famous, he's got all that stuff. And so he comes over and he grabs my foot, picks up my foot and grabs that board and like pulling the arrow out of tunnel or something, you know, and rips that nail out of my foot. Now quit crying and go and see your mom and have her fix your foot. So, you know, I hobble into the house. You know, and you know what you did back in those days, right? Well, how did you fix that kind of stuff?
Bleed, wrap it up a little bit.
Yeah, they squeeze it, let it bleed out a little bit, and then they soak it in Epsom salts, right? And that was the cure of the day. And so I'm sitting there with this,
Is it a good thing?
Is it a good thing, Ben? Anyway. So I sit there. Well, the next Saturday we're working on this barn again, and the next Saturday I go to work around the yard, and I feel that pressure on the bottom of my foot again. Only now I have experience, right? And in the school that we go to, as I'm starting to have that nail pressure hit the bottom of my foot, the central nervous system reacts in your brain and says, hey, dummy, pay attention, there's a nail down here, pick up, you know. Mm-hmm. And within a 30th of a second, we can process those thoughts. And it happens so quick that we don't even think they're thoughts because we're not thinking about those thoughts. Well, what happens to us in trance and why we need to use trance to address these kinds of issues in our life is because trance slows our thought processes down. So those thoughts that are consciously right now, if I were to step on that nail, it would go zip, zip. In trance, it would slow that thought down to the point that if I focused and fixated on that individual thought, I could know what it is. And once I know what that thought actually is, now I'm in a position to understand it, challenge, and change it. Without knowing what that thought is, we'll go on through life repeating the same old mistakes, the same old habits, the same old patterns forever because we have never actually slowed our minds down to find out what it is that we're actually thinking and why we're doing what we're doing. Does that make sense?
So trance, is that
hypnosis?
Slowing down? Oh, trance, okay, thanks.
Yeah, hypnosis or pondering.
Okay.
And so actually, in hypnosis, and there's basically seven layers of hypnosis that we use in here, we observe. And if we have time, I'll explain all seven layers of trance to you. But it's all simple stuff. It's not what, you know, the world portrayed it to be. In these seven states, the first layer of trance down, if you will, or level, stage, you know, we use, is what the world calls daydreaming. And we're all familiar with that. I mean, we're fixated and focused outside of our head somewhere, and yet we're really back inside of our mind, mm-hmm. right? And, you know, so that's the first level of trance down, and it's a natural state. Well, so are all of the other five states. Just as natural, and you go in and out of those states as you go in and out of sleep. So if I have time, I'll explain them to you. And when I do, you're going, oh, yeah, I do that. Oh, yeah, I do that. And they'll be just as naturally understood to you as daydreaming. And my job is to take the whole mystery out of what's called hypnosis or trance. Because all it is the states of mind that we go through as we go to sleep and the states of mind as you come back out of sleep. And so really my main induction in here when I'm working with clients, I simply say, your job is to go half asleep. And everybody gets that. Oh yeah, you mean like that kind of dazed, relaxed feeling I get is, yeah, that's it. That's hypnosis. Okay? The next stimulus is the conscious mind. And the story I use for the conscious mind is that I remember the first time, and you might remember, the first time you started to drive a clutch. I was 8 years old. You could barely see over the top of the dashboard, and we're out hauling hay, and my dad puts me in the truck now. So get in there, let this out real slow, and don't spill the load. I mean, that was my old training, you know. I'm this little kid and driving the truck out through the hayfield. And, you know, that's the way we learned back then. Mm-hmm. That's what we did. And so I learned. I mean, the first time I let that clutch out and I felt that jerk, I mean, I knocked the guy off the back end. You know, let it out slower! You know, I mean, it was one of those days. But you figure it out because we learn to observe, we watch, we do what we do outwardly, and we make conscious observations with our conscious mind. And so outward focus, conscious and learning is consciousness,
And we do that in that conscious part of our mind. Well, all four of those areas of stimulus will generate thoughts. So the T right here is a thought. Okay? Now, if you follow the arrow over here, that thought ends up coming into this half of the circle. Now, the circle here represents our minds, and this half is our conscious mind with the C, and this half here represents our subconscious mind. Okay? Now, our conscious mind right here is analytical and logical. So that's where we do our analytical thinking, our critical thinking, our logical thinking, so on. And we logically think about and analyze those thoughts that come into this part of our mind. Now, if we accept those thoughts as being right, true, and correct for us, we'll allow that thought to go through this line right here, this division. There's a division between conscious and subconscious. And that division between the two minds is what we call the critical factor or critical faculty. And it's the critical faculty and the critical factor because it contains the area of our belief systems. Okay? So our belief systems are made up of all of the thoughts that we've accepted as being right, true, and correct for us from all of the prior stimuluses that we've received in our life.
Right, back up. I'm lost.
Okay?
Okay, you went from...
The thought from these stimuluses comes into our conscious mind. You see this arrow?
Yeah.
If we accept those thoughts as being right, true, and correct for us, then we will allow them to go through this center line here, this barrier. And that's the critical factor right here.
Oh, okay.
And that's, that contains our belief systems. Okay? Now, the critical factor acts as a filter, if you will. If we accept that thought as being right, true, and correct for us, and we will let it go through the filter. If we don't, we filter that thought out. And we use real technical terms in here. We call it bouncing. It's like the thought hits the critical factor like a trampoline cutting, and it just, if you don't accept it, you just bounce it back out, meaning that you don't let it go through the subconscious functions of memories, imaginations, and emotions. If you let the thought through the critical factor and it gets into the subconscious, now it generates a behavior. As long as we can keep that thought in the conscious side of our mind, it doesn't generate a behavior, and that's where we can maintain personal self-control.
Yeah.
Or you can continue to challenge the lies, kick it out, acknowledge that you know what you know, and you don't have to be confused or have doubt, period.
Right.
True or false?
True.
So what do you choose?
Not having it, for sure.
Then you got to do what?
Push it away, tell it to leave, and not let it, if it's there, get rid of it before it takes hold. I guess pull it out and get rid of it before it becomes a monster.
And you know how to do that by catching it in your critical factor and bouncing it out.
Yeah.
But we need to reinforce it. Just like the nice bright white shirt you got. What did you do with it?
I bounced that out.
But you really do need to be confused in life.
No.
You really don't know what you know. How can you ever really know that you know something?
You just do.
You're struggling with that one a little bit.
Yeah.
Feel a difference?
Yeah.
Pay attention here. I like your white shirt. Bounce it out.
Yeah.
Do you know what you know?
Mostly.
If you don't know what you know, who does know what you know?
Right.
Say it, I know what I know.
I know what I know.
Say it again.
I know what I know.
How does that feel different and stronger?
Feels more confident for sure.
Well, acknowledge that you do know what you know.
Yeah.
Nobody else knows what you know. I don't know what you know. How could I know what you know that you know?
Right.
So do you know what you know?
Yes.
Okay, how does that feel different? Do you know that that's a nice white shirt you got on?
Yeah, I know it's not.
Okay. Good. I'm watching your process. You got it?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, please close them back down. Let's finish this up.
Okay. But if that thought gets through, we will go into our memories, and what we do in our memory with it is because we've accepted that as a truth from this experience, we attempt to justify, validate, and defend that belief we've accepted by finding memories that we can skew in the direction of our belief. And that's where we get into all of these clinical statements like, is the glass half full or half empty? Right? We're seeing the world half full or half empty kind of things. Then the thought goes into our imagination, and in our imagination right here, we can amplify that thought from 0 to 2,500 times in our imagination. So we can take any little thought or any little experience right here, and if we get it off into our imagination up to 2,500 times, any little thought, and we've all suffered the biggest ill of humanity, if you will, is the thought of, and from the experiences that we had, I'm not good enough. We've all had some experiences in life where we've just felt like we're not good enough. Now, the I'm not good enough kind of thing, and there's hundreds of thousands of self-limiting beliefs and doubts, right? But let's just stick with that one for a minute. If we take that one that says I'm not good enough, and we were to amplify that by 500 times in our imagination, what kind of emotion do you think that would generate?
Self-esteem.
Yeah, maybe low self-esteem, maybe you feel uncomfortable, maybe uneasy about things. What would you call that emotion if we amplified I'm not good enough by 1,000 times?
Depression.
Pointless, yeah.
Anxiety, maybe?
Yeah.
Okay. What about 1,500 times? Now it might be depression, or we would start to identify it in those kinds of terms. What if we amplified that same thought 2,000 times in our imagination? What emotion would you say that would generate, or what would you name it?
Self-destruction.
Okay. Yeah, you could kind of get there. I would say maybe that's at the 2,500 level, you know.
Yeah.
It might be personal self-sabotage would be good.
Yeah.
You know, and at 2,500 times, you could say you could actually go into really total kind of incapacitation, and you could go into a state of despair and hopelessness, right? And you could get into all of those kinds of things depending on how far you amplify that same thought in your imagination is going to tell you how much emotional content you generate around that and what kinds of names you're going to start to identify that with. Now the cool thing is that we teach you how to adjust, control, shut down the imagination. And we teach you how to take control of the imagination, so no matter what level you've amplified it to, 2,500 times, 500 times, we can teach you how to adjust it, turn it down, and turn it down, and turn it down. Now, the very fact that you've already learned how to turn it up to those extremes, if you have the power to turn it up, then it automatically tells you that if you have the power to turn it up, then you must have the power to turn it down. But nobody's ever taught you how yet. You tracking with me? So as we teach you how to do it and you actually learn that you can start to turn the imagination down, what if you turn it all the way down and you finally click the dial and you just turn it off? Now what you've done is you've actually collapsed the emotional content. And because there is no more emotional content, now you've changed the behavior because we behave the way we feel. Right? We get up in the morning, we feel all grumpy, grouchy, and irritable. How do we behave?
Angry. You're mad at the world.
Yeah. But what we want to recognize is that grumpy, grouchy, irritable behavior is coming out of a grumpy, grouchy, and irritable emotion that's coming out of an overamplified thought. So if we recognize what our behavior is, and through trance we can actually access the thought, challenge and change the thought, now we can alter the perception of the memories, desensitize the imagination, which collapses the emotions, and changes the behavior. You tracking with me? Good to go so far?
What if you're just really stubborn?
Huh?
What if you have a real stubborn person talking?
You can amplify stubborn up to 2,500 times, and you can be as stubborn as you want to be.
So it's the same thing. I'm just going to go back to a thought, and what if that thought is such a strong thought, it's actually a belief system?
Well, they're all belief systems. I'm not good enough as a belief system. They're all stuck right here. I'm going to tell you how we change that right now. You're getting it. But I'm going to overemphasize this until I know everybody's got it. I'm going to tell you a couple more stories. Johnny gets up in the morning, and he's about 40 years old now. Johnny gets up in the morning, he recognizes that it's raining outside. Okay? So the environment is raining, and that becomes his stimulus. So the thought of rain right here goes into the conscious side of his mind. And in consciousness, he analyzes and logically thinks about rain. Now, analytically and logically, he says, okay, it's raining today. It means I've got to change my good leather shoes to my neoprene sole shoes. I'm not going to wear my leather jacket. I'll wear my nylon windbreaker. I better leave work early because traffic's going to be slow. I'm going to need an extra 15 minutes. He makes calculations and adjustments for the fact that it's raining.
He's not 4 years old anymore.
No, he's 40.
Oh, I think
he said 40.
I said 4.
No, 40. I'm sorry.
Wow.
Didn't I say 40? Mm-hmm. I thought I said 40.
Rationalized
it. It's these yoga people. You know, they're all over the wall. Just kidding.
It's a responsible 4-year-old.
So, analytically and logically, he thinks about the stimulus of rain, and he makes the right conscious adjustments. But as that thought process of rain hits his critical factor, where his belief system is about that, when it hits up against the critical factor, his belief system about rain is I hate rain. I hate it when it rains. I really hate rain. Now, because that's what he has lodged in his belief system, that I hate rain. When that thought passes through the critical factor and hits his memories, he goes back in his mind, and the only thing he's thinking about rain is all the things that he can hate. So in his mind, he's thinking, I hate it when it rains because it washes mud down the driveway and out of my flower beds and I have to clean the gutter. And I hate it when it rains because it spots my car and I have to clean the car. And I hate it when it rains because the kids track dirt and mud in the house. And I hate it when it rains. And he goes off on all these things that he can hate because he's just fixated on what he can hate. That's where his mind is fixated and focused, right? So he amplifies that from 0 to 2,500 times. And so let's say he's been doing this for a long time and he's at the 1,500 to 2,000 level of amplification. And he drives on down the freeway and cars are splashing additional dirt and mud on his new car. And by the time he gets to work, how does Johnny behave on rainy days? Yeah, he's angry, he's bitter, he hates it, he just can't stand it. And so he's generating his behavior out of his belief system of I hate rain, coming from that stimulus. Now down the road in the same neighborhood, three doors down, same rainstorm, same neighborhood, same kind of house, everything, lives Mary. Now Mary gets up in the morning and she looks outside and she recognizes, the same as Johnny does, it's raining. The thought stimulus of rain to Mary generates the same kinds of analytical, logical thinking. So Mary also changes her shoes. She changes her leather shoes, her neoprene sole shoes. She takes an umbrella. She leaves for work early. Analytically and logically, in our conscious mind, most all of us respond and act the same. Does that make sense? But when that thought hits up against her critical factor, against her belief system, in Mary's belief system, she has lodged in there in her belief, I love rain. I really love rain. Now, Mary also doesn't want to be wrong. Because we all attempt to justify, validate, and defend our beliefs. You don't want to be wrong. You don't want to be wrong.
You don't want to be wrong. None of us want to be wrong. So we skew our view of the world to justify, validate, and defend our belief. So Mary's looking for all the things about rain in her memory and to justify, validate, and defend it that she can like, love, and enjoy about a good rainstorm. So as she leaves for work, she's driving on the road. Oh, I love when it rains because I know when I get home tonight, my grass is going to be greener. My flowers are going to bloom prettier. The trees are just going to be brighter. The air is going to smell so fresh and clean. The whole world's going to look like it just took a shower. She goes back in her memory. Oh, I remember a week or two ago we had that magnificent thunderstorm across the valley, and the thunder's crashing up against the mountains, and the lightning's flashing everywhere, and I sat at my window, and I just loved watching this magnificent summer thunderstorm. I just love it when it rains. She drives off down to work, and by the time she gets there, she's amplified all of those thoughts from 0 to 2,500 times in her imagination, and how does she behave on a rainy day?
Joyful.
She has a great day. It's like one of her best days ever. She can't wait to get home and see how pretty her flowers are, and how green the grass is, and smell the fresh air. Right? So the point here is that we can have identically the same stimuluses in life. But depending on what we have lodged in our belief system, and as we allow those thoughts to go through, how we're justifying, validating, and defending those in our memories, and how far are we amplifying them in our imagination, is determining how much emotional content, positive or negative, we're placing on it, and that is what's generating our behaviors. Good to go?
Mm-hmm.
Questions. So Johnny comes in, and he comes in the door, and he says, "Hey, Dennis, so, you know, we're chatting. You know, what are you here for, Johnny?" "Well, I want to know why I'm always so angry and irritable and mean on rainy days. I've been that way forever. I just, it's really bothered me, and I just want to see if you can help me with why do I get angry on rainy days? Because that's what we deal with, behaviors." Right? So that's called deductive processing. So you see the D at the bottom? The behavior was induced down this side. We're going to do deductive processing now. We're going to do deductive processing now, coming back this direction. Now, right here at deductive processing, it simply means that we recognize that there's a behavior that we want to change. And the behavior is, why am I angry, irritated, mean and ornery on rainy days? So right here we induce trance. Okay? Right here we induce trance. Now, what we mean by trance is what we call hypnosis. Only we have, we want to go to like the fourth level of trance down that we call catalepsy. Now, in catalepsy trance, at that level, what happens is that the person gets access to conscious and subconscious functions at one and the same time. So right now, for example, if I were to ask, Anne, if I said, what experience have you had in life that's still holding you back, binding you down, and keeping you from being all you really want to be? You know, kind of the greatness that Tony talked about. I know I've got the sense of greatness about me, but I'm just not able to bring it out the way I'd like to, or whatever, right? So what experience have you had that's still holding you back, binding you down, and keeping you from being all you want to be? Well, now, consciously, people really can't tell us because they buried it years ago with our primary defense mechanisms. If you want to fill this one out at the top. Our primary defense mechanisms are amnesia and denial. Amnesia. I never want to talk about that again. I never want to think about that again. Let's never have this conversation again. Don't ever bring that up to me again. Now, because our conscious mind is the director of our subconscious mind, the conscious mind is the master, if you will. And the subconscious mind is the genie in the bottle. So if the master directs the subconscious mind to hide it from it, the genie goes to work and does the best it can to hide it from the painful thought or the experience or whatever and attempts to bury it in the memory, in the subconscious. So amnesia is a real thing. So people will come in and say, I don't know why I do this. I haven't And yet when we go back into trance, what trance does is it gives us access to those subconscious memories over here. And every thought, every touch, every smell, every sensory perception you've ever had, every conversation you've ever had from birth until now, is all in there and is all accessible through trance. And it just comes up. So we don't have to ask you, a test of 100 questions, and if you answer 25 of them this way, it means this, or 35 more means that, or we simply have to achieve the right level of trance, ask you the right questions, and boom, your personal information will come up.
My name is Deanne Smith. I'm a hypnotherapy student. And during the day, I work as a school psychologist. As a school psychologist, one of my duties is to work with students to help them change their behavior, to bring about behavior modification. And most of the programs I have are maybe 10 sessions long or 16 sessions long, so it takes a good deal of time. I was amazed my first night of class when I came here and watched Dennis do in one or two sessions what takes me weeks to accomplish. On a personal level, I was able to overcome some of my own self-limiting doubts and beliefs that I've had since childhood and learned how to manage my mind so that I can take care of those same problems in the future if they come back. Even if I never used these skills in a career, it has been worth it to know that I can help my friends and family and myself. I would recommend this school to anyone that wants to learn more about themselves or wants to learn how to help people to change their behavior.
And that's what we call people get to learn their own personal truths in here. Your personal truth is what are your I love or I hate reins? You know, what's either promoting you forward in life like I love rain, or what's holding you back in life like I hate rain? And we all have a number of those deep-seated inappropriate beliefs that are inhibiting us, holding us back, or are promoting us and prompting us forward. So we did a session, and we've done some desensitizing work and taught you some things. And tell me, if you would, how that's going for you. I mean, we did this one a week ago, roughly.
Yeah.
And we started to teach you some of our mind management techniques and skills. And tell me what you've done with that and how that's working.
I've really been able to recognize those thoughts when they come in, that filter. I've been able to really recognize that and to either bounce those thoughts out or if they did enter, to bring them up to reality and flush them out of my mind. And so it's been amazing. I've had no problems this whole entire time. Of course, you have lots of temptations, but just bouncing right back out, and it's been fantastic. So,
good for you. And you did all that. Yeah, you did all that in one session. I told you you're like a trance superstar here. I mean, you've gotten in.
Yeah.
Went to work and got it done.
Yeah, it was amazing, honestly.
Okay. So you're in more control.
A lot more control. Yeah.
And so today what I want to do is I want to expand what we did. So right here, Johnny comes in, we induce trance. We go to this fourth level of trance of catalepsy, where we get access to conscious and subconscious functions at one and the same time. And we start back and we go through the emotions. So we will prompt into the emotional content, because we want them to feel what it feels like and give us an identity of the feeling on a rainy day. Now what we're really doing is we're connecting the dots between the subconscious and conscious mind, between the thought and the emotion. So we have them tell us, you know, how did that feel? Now the more emotional content that they bring up in that regression process there, it's called a regression, the more emotional content they bring up tells me how much they've actually amplified it in their imagination. So everybody cries.
Can you see I got big boxes of food here? That's the natural venting process of the body and the mind. And so people will start to vent automatically in trance. And that's where some people who've never actually been trained in hypnotherapy, so they get worried about hypnosis, because I heard this one psychologist one time over in this meeting. Well, I don't use hypnosis because I hypnotized somebody one time. I tried to do it. All of a sudden, they started to cry and they started to, you know, weep and carry on. I didn't know what to do. They said hypnosis caused them to have an emotional breakdown. Well, it doesn't cause anything. It reveals it. It helps release it. And one of the best things that we do for people in here is we put them in a position where they can actually vent that stuff off. And I call it just empty that emotional box. And one of the greatest parts of the therapy is they get to release all that penned-up emotional content. Then my job is to teach them how not to refill the box. Right? But that's a very relieving part of what we do, is we help them vent off that emotional content. So depending on how far they've amplified their imagination, and part of how we teach them how not to refill the box, I already told you, we would help you learn how to control and turn down the imagination. So from 0 to 2,500 times, you can create as much emotional content as you want around any issue. But it's so relieving for people to be able to come in and learn how to turn it down. And then turn it off and control it themselves. So Johnny's in the chair. We get him through his emotional content. We start to desense the imagination. And we get into the memory right here. Now, Johnny's 40, hasn't remembered or thought about this stuff for 30-something years. In the chair, all of a sudden, he's back in his mind, in his memory, and he's 6 years old. And at 6 years old, he's got his nose pressed up against the living room window. And as his nose is pressed up against the living room window, it's been raining now for 3 days. And for 3 days, he's been looking out the door, or out the window at the Tonka trucks in the sandbox to the side of the house. His buddies next door haven't been able to come over and play, because mom's got her belief system in effect. Well, Johnny, you can't go out and play, you'll track mom in the house, and you can't go out and play, you'll catch a cold, and you can't go out and play, right? You'll get all wet. And so for 3 days, he's been all cooped up, and at the end of 3 days, he's had it. I hate it when it rains. I hate rain. I just can't stand rain. Now, as a little kid, they don't have a very well-developed critical factor and belief system here yet. So all those thoughts really get lodged and get amplified to a huge degree. Now in the chair, he goes back through the emotional content. That has been lodged there ever since 6 years old. And he's been acting like he's 6 years old ever since, and he's 40. At 40, he's still acting like he's six. He still gets angry, irritated, and ornery because he hates rain. But now he's forgotten all about the sandbox years ago. Now it's about, it spots his new car, it washes mud in the driveway. His whole focus has changed, but the underlying belief system and the behavior is the same. Does that make any sense? Mm-hmm. So in the chair, he gets to go back and realize that, okay, at 6 years old, I created this. And then that's when I actually get to play therapist. Up to that point, I've just been a hypnotist. So my job as a therapist, then, really, it's not that complicated. I get to start to challenge him. And anything I get to challenge him, because we bring it. Come on in.
Hello, is this a mind then?
It is. You found us.
Yes, at last.
Have you been looking?
Yes.
Sorry about that.
Where shall I sit?
Right here would be fine. If you'd like, you're over there. We're filling out this little chart. Okay. So where we're at is we're right here. Now this isn't going to mean much to you for a while, but what I'll do is, because I'm recording this for some students, if you want to give me your email address when this is over, I'll send you a link to the recording and you could go back and watch this.
Okay, good.
How would that be? Okay. So Johnny's in the chair, he goes back to age six, and he's got his nose pressed against the window, and all of that information now comes back to consciousness, because we bring that information back from the subconscious back to the conscious side of the mind. Because we have conscious and subconscious functions at one and the same time in catalepsy,
We bring that back to the conscious side of the mind, to what we call the initial sensitizing event. The initial sensitizing event is this experience up here that he had with the stimulus of rain in the first place. Now, again, at that point, that's when I get to play therapist. And my job is really just to challenge that belief system that he's accepted right here about rain. So I start out, hey, Johnny. I explain this chart to him because this is core critical to understanding what people are doing in the first place. I said, Johnny, okay, let's get real here. Don't you really like the fresh, clean smell of the air after a fresh rainstorm? And the response always is, well, you know what? I've never thought about it. And as obvious as that may seem to you, to a person who's stuck in that belief system, they haven't ever thought about it, because all he's been trying to do is justify, validate, and defend his belief of I hate rain. So he's only been looking for things in life that he can hate, or things about rain that he can hate. Well, Johnny, don't you like the fact that your grass gets greener, the flowers bloom prettier, the trees are brighter, the whole world looks like you just took a shower? Well, you know what? Now I think about it. Yeah, I actually do, but I've never thought about that before. And so what happens to us is we get this little slice of our pie that we're trying to justify, validate, and defend. And my job is to open up some 360 thinking. That's my job. My job is to help people get a more of a 360 view of life instead of this little slice of the pie that they've gotten themselves locked into in their thought processes and their behavior patterns. So every thought that I can get him to accept with me, yeah, I like the fresh air, yeah, I like the green grass, everything that I can get him to accept is altering the perception of the memories. Because then I'll have him go back. Think about the last storm you were just in. When you came home, wasn't the grass greener? Oh, yeah. Yeah, it really was. Wasn't the air fresher? Yeah, it really was. So now I'm altering the perception of the memory. I'm not altering reality. But we alter the perception because we're including more information that they haven't considered before in a positive way. So everything I can get him to accept alters the perception of the memory, desensitizes the imagination, which collapses the emotions, and now we've changed his behavior. Cool, huh? Yeah, it is. I mean, it's fun work. I love what I do, and I like to watch the change in people's faces and, you know, their demeanor. And you know what? One of the highlights of my life really is I love those days when somebody comes in the door and they're all burdened down with their, you know, we're real clinical. Their stuff. They're stinking thinking, you know. Mm-hmm. And they're all burdened down with it. They've carried it for years. And we teach them this process, and we go in, and in just an hour or two, they're able to dump off two or three major belief systems and challenge and change them and free up all their memories, their emotional content, shut down their imaginations. And I mean, it's like a miracle. But this is how we do it. I mean, you need to know that we're actually following a process, and we know what we're doing. It's going to be good for you. You know, that kind of stuff. So I've gone on for quite a while. Questions?
I'm sure you have people that you run into that feel like sometimes it's not healthy to dig up the past.
Yeah. Yeah, I know, and I hear that.
I have a husband that would probably say those exact words.
Sure, I get that. But in trance, the way we do that in here is, okay, what we tell people is we're going to start with whatever your heart, mind, spirit, intelligence wants to work with first. Because your spirit knows. Okay? So what will happen is, I'll give you this little thing down here to answer your question. This is called layering. Okay. Now, layering is twofold. If you will. Get that okay? Mm-hmm. You might look at this as a target. And, you know, as therapists, we always like to hit bullseyes, you know, meaning we're going to blow out some big core issue and see this miraculous stuff. And, of course, we like that, right? But if you look at it as a target, some people, what they don't understand is that you can sit and talk about this stuff on the conscious side of the mind cognitively forever. But unless you get trance access and you pull these roots out, you can whack away at all the leaves and all the branches and all the stuff. But if you don't get on the other side and pull the root out, it always keeps growing back. Yes?
That's kind of my question. What about Johnny, who is 6 years old and he's decided he hates rain?
Right.
But now, not only does he hate rain, he starts to hate everything. He's like building a foundation of a way of thinking, so his life is skewed. And so he comes in and now he learns how to love rain, but what about his whole life that he hates now? I mean, how do you help someone that's like a victim, that's just now lives a life completely different, and you go through affirmations or whatever therapies, how do you connect the dots and just like dominoes tumble?
Great question. What happens is, back to my layering chart, if he hates rain, and hate is a core issue, so it's turned from rain to hating everything.
Right.
So hate's the core issue. But they'll come in here and through trance, we'll pull the root out and we'll blow out a core issue. Then what they do in their own mind is they say, yeah, and I hate this, and I've hated that, and I hate that. And they'll start tying all those together, which we call secondary layers. And they'll work out through their secondary layers, and we help them with that sometimes, and we teach them how to do it themselves. And most of the work that people do in here, they do on their own after sessions, because we set them up to continue to do their work all week long during in between sessions. So we get stuff done here very quickly.
So if you were to say from the other night, the other Saturday when we worked together, we worked pretty much on a specific issue.
Mm-hmm.
How's that been better for you since then?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. That truly feels like that's a totally clean slate. That's done.
How cool is that?
That is very cool.
I mean, you struggled with that for
most of my life.
Okay.
You know, almost 50 years. 48 years.
And like you said just a minute ago, you know when you hit an area of truth or whatever, so you feel really confident. That's closure when we move on.
Yes, that's very much, that's closure. I feel very good about that.
Good. Well, let's get to work and see what else we can get done.
Okay.
It's very surgical in the sense that we're going in and pulling out roots, and we do it at a pretty rapid rate. And then we also teach them how to continue to pull out their own roots, so they're self-maintaining.
Okay, then what about a person who has planted this garden, and that's what they know, and they don't want to pick up their roots, because then they're very vulnerable. You know what I mean? Do you teach how to, like, replant?
Yeah. So those people will come in and they'll start out slower. And so they'll start on an outside layer. And then we'll conquer one little layer here, and then another layer here. And every layer that we get done gives them greater mental, emotional, psychic energy, power, to conquer the next layer. Does that make sense? And so they'll work their way in. And every layer that we get done, now they're picking up greater emotional, mental strength. When they finally hit the core, now the core is not that big a deal because they have all of this other energy freed up. They have all this other psychic, mental, spiritual ability they didn't have before. So when they finally get to the core, yeah, that's bothering me my whole life, but I'm ready to take it on, and they do it, and then they dump out the whole thing. So some people come in, they'll go to the core, and they'll work their way out. Other people will come in, and they'll want to work their way in. And it doesn't matter to us which way they want to do it. There's not a right or wrong to it. It's just different. Just what they're ready to do.
Do you now recognize that your behaviors are being created from your current belief systems? You can learn new mental skills and learn to challenge and change your current inappropriate belief systems, changing them at will to new, more productive belief systems that are goal-achieving. You will overcome fears, hesitations, and eliminate procrastination.
in hypnosis and hypnotherapy, that's what we do, is we help people change and alter and modify their personal behaviors. So if a person comes in and they have a behavior, that behavior was created from a stimulus, and that's the Webster's Dictionary version of it, if you will, that a behavior is activity created from a stimulus. I'm paraphrasing that, but you can look that up. So that stimulus effect, if you will, generated thoughts. So our behaviors start as a thought from a stimulus. So we had this experience in school, and maybe it was in grade school, and when most people come in to do hypnotherapy, they start back at their original issues. Mom and dad issues, preschool, some grade school issues, and high school, and so on, where we took on this stimulus of people saying, you know, maybe something negative about us, you know, and we took on the belief that I'm not smart enough, or I'm stupid, or people have all of these things that have been buried in their subconscious belief system that still affect them to this day if it's never been appropriately challenged and changed. So what we do is, again, is that we have a stimulus, and that stimulus generates these thoughts. These thoughts now pass through our critical factor area of the mind, if you will. And this critical factor area is where we filter out right and wrong, good and evil, worthy, unworthy kinds of things. But then once that thought is allowed to pass through this critical factor filter, or the critical faculty as it's called, now it will hit the subconscious mind. Once it hits subconscious functions, it goes through the imagination, and the imagination can amplify any thought in our school of thought up from 0 to 2,500 times. But the point is that it amplifies it to a very great degree. So the imagination amplifies the thought. Now that thought passes through our memories. In our memories, our mind does a memory search, if you will, and looks for justifying, validating, and defending data from prior experiences. From our memory, as we justify, validate, and defend the belief system thought that we've incorporated now from the stimulus, now that all dumps onto our emotions, and in an overamplified emotional state, our emotions generate our behaviors because we tend to behave the way we feel. So, in a simple way, if we get up in the morning and we feel all grumpy, grouchy, and irritable, how do we behave? Well, that grumpy, grouchy, irritable behavior is coming out of a grumpy, grouchy, irritable feeling that is coming out of a grumpy, grouchy, irritable, overamplified thought. So, what trance does is trance gives us access to the subconscious. And as we have subconscious access, now we can go in, and through trance, it actually slows the thought processes down. So people may have a lot of chatter going on in their head all the time, and yet trance will slow that chatter down, and we can isolate thoughts one thought at a time in trance.
How does that feel no different?
It feels peaceful.
How does it feel to be hopeful?
It feels way better.
Peaceful?
Yeah.
Calm? Self-empowered?
Yeah.
Where's all the mind chatter gone?
I don't know.
How cool is
just
that?
Just gone, yeah. It's really nice.
You said you've been fighting with it for days.
In weeks, months.
Weeks, months?
Yeah, it just kept growing and growing and growing.
Clear-minded?
Yeah, that's good.
Where are you at inside your own head right now? Take your index finger. Perfect. You know that?
Yeah.
Outward, conscious, focus, clear. Anything else you needed to cover today?
No, that was great.
High five, pal. Good job.
Thanks.
Yeah. That's it.
And as we isolate that grumpy, grouchy, irritable thought, and as we challenge and change it, and we change it appropriately, now what we have done, as we've changed the thought, we have now desensitized, and it desensitizes the imagination. As the imagination is desensitized, we go into the memories, and now we alter the perception of that original stimulus. So the perception has changed, therefore we've collapsed the emotions. Now we've changed the behavior.
Hypnotherapy or meditation is utilized for behavioral modification. We can learn to successfully apply these processes to make the changes in our life we have always wanted. These processes allow us to move forward uninhibited by experiences of the past, achieving our goals more rapidly as we are free of fear anger, guilt, and other negative emotions that have inhibited us and bound us down. We are to make all of our life's experiences good by learning to do good from the lessons learned from the experiences. We make our life good by doing good from the lessons learned from the experiences. Attend mind management trainings. These classes are generally 16 hours of training, accomplished in a combination of online videos, virtual online classroom attendance, or in-person participation in Farmington, Utah at the school. We guarantee our work and your success with these processes, but you must do the work. To be successful, you must do the work. The work is: watch the training videos and understand the processes, attend the mind management classes in Farmington or online, do the homework, study the course book, listen to the CDs, journal experiences of change, and learn to be happy. Learn self-hypnosis or pondering. Learn and apply and practice mind management processes daily. Our guarantee is another opportunity free. When you participate in a mind management group training and coaching in self-hypnosis for personal behavior modification, and at the end of the class schedule, if you have had to miss a class or for any reason you are not satisfied with where you are in your personal understanding and progress, or you would just like to continue your interpersonal behavioral modification work with assisted practice, improving your self-hypnosis skills, you may participate in another group of the same subject as the one you attended free. This gives you an additional 16 hours in the next available scheduled group of your subject free. This gives you plenty of time, chance, and opportunity to gain further understanding and practice of your self-hypnosis skills. We want to assist you in your goal achievement and have you be your own best behavioral therapist. Learn new interpersonal communication skills and personal problem-solving techniques, understanding yourself and others from the inside out. Learn the secret to inner positive self-talk and learn to be more personally, internally competent. Be confident, be effective, be happy, and have peace of mind. People need to know how to be mentally tough. Being able to disassociate from negative comments and avoid being offended from experiences had by most of us throughout our daily activities. If we are too easily offended and isolate ourselves, it keeps us from the very people we need to be with to overcome the negative feelings and be free again. We teach and train people in mental toughness, the same as we do the professional coaches and athletes we work with in our sports mind management programs. Inappropriate negative thoughts accumulate in the subconscious mind as negative emotional stress. This stress compounds over time in our imagination. This imaginary compounding increases negative emotional energy, and if not understood and regularly desensitized and released, becomes crippling to our motivational drive, performance, and personal health. Learn the overall health benefits of pondering and meditation, achieving deep rest, relaxation, and sleep. Learn how to be more mentally proficient and effective in handling the increased stresses of life today. What would it be worth to correct the inappropriate "I hate rain" beliefs in your life? More than a More than a... More than what? What would it be worth? Can you establish its value over a lifetime of increased productivity, being clear and free-minded, living without fears, personal doubts, and procrastinations? What about other beliefs or thoughts that may be guiding our behaviors in a negative way? How about other people that we know? Could they benefit as well? What would that mean to your business, spouse, kids, friends, and to you? It would be interesting to place a value on that. If beliefs were able to be corrected and improved, life would change in a dramatic way, and you get the point. Are you willing to make an investment of a little time and a little money to learn and experience the principles of how real and long-lasting positive change works? If you have 16 hours and less money than the cost of an iPad, we can teach you how to. It is called mind management, and it applies to many areas like sales, personal performance, family improvement, and so forth. We are so confident of the processes that we guarantee them when you take the full course and do the required trainings. This process works. It may not be easy, but it will be well worth the effort, and the return will be a huge relief from carrying around old incorrect beliefs, inappropriate habits, and maladaptive behaviors. After all, wouldn't you really enjoy being free from packing around your burdens of the past? Remember, you will have to spend the time and be willing to do your personal work, meaning you learn to think about the way you think. Are you ready? For 16 hours of experiential learnings in a combination of online video trainings, in-class experience, either at the school in Farmington, Utah, or online in a virtual classroom setting, you will change your life. What you thought was all about will be new and refreshing to you. You will enjoy learning to manage your own mind and thoughts. The course is about learning to think about the way you think. It will give you new perspectives of how thoughts and behaviors, when challenged and changed appropriately, make real meaningful change happen. Yes, you will know how it really takes place, both in concept and through actual experience. We will give you the training to make positive change quickly, or in other words, what we are calling going past light speed at the speed of thoughts. Again, a mind management experience is twofold: the speed at which we can make behavioral change, and two, the speed at which we can move forward to reach new levels of performance once the change happens. It will come about by a process of alignment, correcting, and deliberate actions that require conscious and subconscious thoughts being aligned into harmony, working in sync at one and the same time. Individual sessions, or the mind management course process, includes developing an understanding and utilization of self-hypnosis, learning specific hypnotherapy processes to clear your mind of past sensitizing fixations, and personal problem solving. Then, once you are free-minded, teach you how to maintain your clear and free mind with mind management principles and processes. These processes work when you do. The work is to learn to think about the way you are thinking and challenge and change inappropriate thoughts, selecting new, more appropriate goal-directed thoughts and actions which you choose as being right for you. The 10 principles. Understanding of the 10 principles identified in the introduction are the foundation stones that we carefully lay into place so that strength and longevity are assured. Number 1, the iceberg, conscious and subconscious thoughts. 2. The mind. 3. The wall, the effect of an incorrect belief. 4. Relaxation, the key. 5. Memory, imagination, and emotion. 6-10, the theory of behavior and change. Combined with the 10 principles, these 4 key elements make possible amazing geometric outcomes. Here they are, along with an understanding of each: pondering or hypnosis, meditation or hypnotherapy, core beliefs, critical factor, goal setting, and goal achievement. Pondering or hypnosis. Definition: to consider something deeply and thoroughly, to weigh carefully in the mind. Have you caught the big aha moment? Pondering, in its true sense, is the proper application and implementation of correct self-hypnosis principles and techniques. Or most of us would say that in reverse. Or many of us would say that in reverse. Please realize that we are now leaving the bridge of the Titanic and the incorrect thinking of the past. We are now climbing aboard a world-class sailing ship that will take us to a new and better undiscovered world. This is the core. Here is a challenge. Learn something new and different and let go of your old beliefs and stereotypes of the past regarding self-hypnosis and hypnotherapy. Learn proven processes. This course offers many new technologies in mind skills. You will understand what pondering really is and what it can do for you. You will experience what we mean by mind management. Meditation or hypnotherapy. Definition: to train, calm, or empty the mind, often by achieving an altered state, as by focusing on a single object. If you have ever taken or been involved in a natural childbirth class, you have been taught how to focus on a single object. The single object that we focus on in mind management is the experience that is inhibiting us or preventing our growth and development. And we deal with these experiences one experience at a time, one after another, until we have come to a clear mind, meaning that our mind has become free and clear of all past sensitizing events. Core beliefs or critical factor. Core beliefs are the cornerstones that make up who we are and are contained in our critical factor. They have been developed throughout our lives, particularly at the early stages of our lives between birth and about 9 years of age. They can be based on true and correct principles, which gives a person an incredible lift and momentum throughout their life. Or they can be intentionally or unintentionally false and incorrect misrepresentations of ourselves to ourselves, misunderstandings, misinterpretations of the situation and circumstances. If these core beliefs are in the incorrect self-limiting, self-defeating category, they need to be resolved and made right in order to free up the intelligence of the spiritual mind. The mind can then focus on positive goal-directed outcomes. Goal setting and goal achievement. Goal setting is setting ourselves up for future successes, sort of seeking the future in advance and putting our beliefs in action in positive ways, fortified with accountability. Goals set the law of attraction into motion, wherein we attract the people, circumstances, places, and things into our lives which harmonize with our most predominant thoughts. We will incorporate all of the basic goal-setting principles and concepts into this program that we know work from years of experience. We will assist in the development of impulse control, as it reinforces the new behaviors until they become the dominant patterns and new lifestyle. There are no new methods for goal setting. We have our own and they are fundamental. Our process is simple to understand and easy to implement and achieve. We have spent a considerable amount of time teaching and explaining several behavioral techniques, including self-hypnosis and other processes. A greater, more complete explanation will come in the 16-hour course trainings. Hopefully, we have laid out a very compelling case for the need to challenge and change our own beliefs. Those beliefs may be current or in the past or both. History unveils the falsehoods of long ago, but how do we discover the incorrect beliefs that may exist in our own personal lives? Personal mind management teaches you how. What beliefs in your world need to be challenged and changed? What do you have to lose but a few self-limiting beliefs that are keeping you from what you want most? We don't know what you want most, but you do. We will help you discover inhibitions and move forward without hesitations. No more procrastinations. Please consider, we believe that you and others who participate will achieve more than ever before, because we will teach you new principles that you have never known or understood before, but yet are very familiar with, as we are teaching what the mind does anyway, naturally. It will give you the tools and experiential learning necessary to change old beliefs and behaviors for new positive ones. You will learn the power of the subconscious mind and harness it for your own goal-driven purposes. Remember the I hate rain example? If you can get rid of the I hates or other negatives in your life, whether they be personal, business, sports, community, and so forth, and replace them with corrected truths and beliefs, then you will experience what mind management really is, the power to move forward in life at the speed of thought. Enjoy a free mind and learn to maintain it utilizing mind management. Join a 16-hour group of mind management trainings and get started on clearing your mind of past fixations and problems. Please schedule your personal attendance in Farmington, Utah, in a mind management group or for individual sessions with Dennis at Advanced Health Clinic. Phone 801-447-8680. Or to schedule online attendance of a mind management group, or to schedule individual sessions of hypnotherapy online utilizing Skype and so forth with Dennis Parker, phone 801-628-0693 or email Dennis at wdennisparker@msn.com. Please visit our website at certifiedhypnotherapytraining.com. Thank you. We look forward to visiting with you in the near future.